السلام علیکم ورحمۃ اللہ
وعلیکم
اشہد ان لا الہ الا اللہ وحدہ لا شریک لہ واشہد ان محمدًا عبدہ ورسولہ اما بعد فاعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم I ask you not to give up your people. I ask you not to stand by me. Instead, you may give me up and stand by your people. But the one and only God is my witness when I say that even if they were to place the sun on my right and the moon on my left, I would not desist from preaching the truth of the one God. I must go on doing so until I die. You can choose your own pleasure. These respected chairmen and revered guests are some of the most recognizable, most poignant, and memorably stirring words ever recorded in the annals of history, and which must have echoed and reverberated throughout the whole of Arabia, and which must have pierced like sharp daggers into the heart of every enemy of the Holy Prophet of Islam, Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These were the words, unequivocal and graphic in content, addressed to his uncle Hazrat Abu Talib by the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that were to become the yardstick by which the levels of sacrifice would be measured. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a simple man of even simpler means, with natural human feelings, charged with the greatest responsibility ever thrust upon any human being, was time and again baited and tempted with secular and worldly riches beyond anyone's wildest imaginations. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam never ever gave the enticement and temptation a second thought, because the spirit of sacrifice for the sake of establishing the unity of God on earth, so deeply entrenched in the noble person of the Holy Prophet, was to serve an example for the rest of humanity. The spirit of sacrifice in terms of time, wealth, honor and life has been handed down through generations by all the prophets of God and their sincere followers. But it found its culmination and its acme in the noble person of the Holy Prophet of Islam, Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The sacrifices that are now being made by members of the Ahmadiyya Jama'at are linked incontrovertibly with those of the companions of the Holy Prophet. There is a strong spiritual umbilical link that will never be cut off. Historically, though, the spiritual umbilical link can be traced back to the patriarchal prophet Abraham alayhi salam. The sacrifices offered by the companions of the Holy Prophet really sprang from the sacrifices offered by Prophet Abraham, his wife Hagar, and their son Prophet Ishmael, peace be on all of them. They had all submitted without any reluctance whatsoever to the will of God. So great was their sacrifice that it is a subject of every sermon wherever Eid al-Azhya is celebrated all over the world. The fruits of that great sacrifice are being reaped even to this day. The spirit of sacrifice is common to all religions because all religions emanate from the same divine source. The concept of sacrifice, according to Islam, is in sacrificing one's all for the sake of God and in the way of God. Those who have full realization of this concept of sacrifice are called in the language of the Holy Quran, Al-Mukhbitin. Allah says in Surah Al-Hajj, chapter 22, verses 35 to 36, فَإِلَاهُكُمْ إِلَاهُمْ وَاحِدٌ فَلَهُ أَسْلِمُوا وَبَشِّرِ الْمُخْبِتِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرِ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَالصَّابِرِينَ عَلَى مَا أَصَابَهُمْ وَالْمُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ So your God is one God. Therefore submit ye all to Him, and give thou glad tidings to the humble, whose hearts are filled with fear when the name of Allah is mentioned, and who patiently endure whatever befalls them, and who observe prayer and spend out of what we have provided for them. And the very first al-mukhbitin in the history of Islam were the noble companions of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The tortures and the persecution and the humiliation that they had to suffer and endure at the hands of their enemies for professing their undying faith in the unity of God and their unconditional loyalty to the Holy Prophet of Islam would send shivers down one's spine. Being laid on hot sand with heavy hot stones placed on their chests, their limbs dismembered, being tied to two camels and their bodies being literally torn apart, was just some of the cruelties meted out to them, the like of which had never been seen before and never been witnessed since. These cruelties were beyond endurance, but early believers were able to bear them because their hearts were made stronger by daily assurances received from God. Were this not so, the faithful could not have withstood the cruelties to which they were subjected. The sacrifices made by all the Holy Prophet's companions, Hazrat Bilal and Hazrat Zayd among them, were not wasted, but in fact, they were the key contributing factors that led the whole of Arabia to be drawn towards Islam. It has to be said that these noble companions were indeed a breed apart, and the rest of us can only strive to reach the base of the dizzy heights that they scaled. It was due to their sacrifices that the world went through a dramatic change and unprecedented blessings began to be showered upon it. With the advent of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, a new era began and the phenomena of sacrifice was renewed. In the declaration of initiation, which every Ahmadi asserts, whether we are born Ahmadis or converts to Ahmadiyyat, we promise to do our best to abide by the 10 conditions of Ba'ath as prescribed by the promised Messiah. The 10 conditions encapsulate the quintessence of the laws of Sharia, and conditions 5, 8, and 9 relate specifically to the subject of sacrifice. Why then has so much importance and status been given to the subject of sacrifice? Reformers and prophets have always appeared from the ordinary stock of human beings and have always been rejected and scorned by man. Their followers have been thrown out of their homes. They have been driven into exile, threatened with starvation, put to the sword, families forcibly split up, and so on and so forth. When this has been the case in history since the days of Adam to the days of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how can we as Ahmadis then accept that it would be any different in the days of the promised Messiah and his followers? How can we as Ahmadis and true Muslims then accept that Muslims will inherit the earth without shedding a drop of our own blood and without making a stroke of effort? How can we as Ahmadi Muslims then believe that we will succeed without treading the path of sacrifice? It did not happen before, it will not happen again. The promised Messiah affirms this eternal and everlasting truth when he warns thus, "There has not been a prophet who was not laughed at, so it was to be that people will laugh at the promised Messiah." And the promised Messiah indeed reminds us of the Quranic injunction regarding sacrifice in Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse 93. "لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ وَمَا تُنْفِقُوا مِنْ شَيْءٍ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ بِهِ عَلِيمٌ." Never shall you attain to righteousness unless you spend out of that which you love, and whatever you spend, Allah surely knows it well. In the very early years of his ministry, keeping in mind the sorry condition of the Muslims at that time, the promised Messiah ﷺ published the first public statement and invitation, which spelled out the divinely appointed plan for the victory of Islam called Fateh Islam. He called upon Muslims to come forward and help in the task he had undertaken for establishing the truth and dignity of Islam, which would require sacrifices in different forms, and he also gave glad tidings of the fruits that these sacrifices would bring. All this is captured in a couple of sonnets which feature in the book. I quote, "Incline not, O brother, to the wealth of this wretched world. Deadly poison is every drop that seems like honey to you. Will you exert for the faith with your persons and your properties? Then from the Lord of the throne will you receive the cloak of his approval." The history of Ahmadiyyat, comparatively still very much in its infancy, is already sprinkled with instances of remarkable and astounding sacrifices of all description in terms of wealth, time, honor, and the ultimate sacrifice of life, whenever they are demanded. And the ultimate sacrifice of life, the martyrs of Ahmadiyya, has been the subject of Huzoor's Friday sermons for the last number of weeks. As I could in no way match the elucidating, eloquent, and spellbinding manner of Hazrat Amir Mu'mineen's discourses, nor the in-depth content of the subject, I have decided to concentrate on other aspects of sacrifice. The Holy Quran clearly chokes out the guidelines for the offering of sacrifices in Surah Al-Saf, chapter 61, verses 11 to 12. Ya ayyuha allazina amanu hal adullukum ala tijaratin tujniikum min azabin aleem. Tuminuna billahi wa rasoolihi wa tujahiduna fi sabilillahi bi amwalikum wa anfusikum. Zalikum khairullakum in kuntum ta'lamun. O you who believe, shall I point out to you a bargain that will save you from a painful punishment, that you believe in Allah and His Messenger and strive in the cause of Allah with your wealth and your persons? That is better for you if you did but know. The promised Messiah and in turn His Khulafa have under divine guidance appealed to the community for different forms of sacrifice according to the need of the time. In the little time left available, I shall try to relate a few examples of the different forms of these extraordinary sacrifices performed by equally extraordinary people. During the early part of the era of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, in the absence of religious wars, monetary sacrifice was given precedence over other forms of sacrifice for some time. This was the time when Islam was being attacked by all and sundry and was indeed in a defenseless state. This was the time when Islam needed to be defended by the pen, and Allah, in all His resplendent and magnanimous glory, bestowed upon the world a writer of prolific and exceptional ability, who managed to write a prodigious number of books, which totaled more than 80, every one of them a masterpiece. All these books were dedicated to protecting the faith, vindicating the noble character of the Holy Prophet of Islam, and restoring Islam to its original pristine purity. This was also the time when the printing of books was an extremely expensive and extravagant affair. The members of the Ahmadi community were few in numbers and extremely meager of resources. But this was more than compensated by their overwhelming zeal and desire to sacrifice their all for the sake of their faith. And so it was. The work of the Almighty was accomplished, with help coming from all directions and in all shapes and sizes. The promised Messiah was blessed with the company and services of one Maulvi Hakim Nuruddin, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, may Allah be pleased with him, one of the greatest of our ancestors. He dedicated his all for the sake of his faith. The sacrifices of Hazrat Maulvi Nuruddin, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, are legendary in the history of Ahmadiyyat, so much so that the promised Messiah himself gave him accolades of the highest order. For example, in his book, Victory of Islam, the promised Messiah writes glowingly, and I quote, I feel greatly moved to mention a spiritual brother of mine whose name, like the Nur, the light of his sincerity, is Nuruddin, light of faith. The services he is rendering in the cause of the spread of Islam out of his cleanly earned money makes me envious. Would that I could also render such services. Nuruddin is ready to do whatever obedience to God and his Prophet requires. At all times, with all his savings, his sinews, and his resources. I know this about him, to say nothing of sacrificing riches, he will not hesitate to sacrifice his life and honor for my sake." Unquote. The fruits of his extraordinary services culminated in Hazrat Sahib being elected unanimously to the high status of the very first Khalifa of the Ahmadiyya movement. So concerned was the promised Messiah about the overflowing selfless sacrifices offered by his beloved Hazrat Maulvi Nuruddin that he was made to remark that it would be cruel to put the entire load of sacrifice on the shoulders of one selfless devotee. The duty to serve the cause, the promised Messiah remarked, devolved on the whole community. And sure enough, other very noteworthy devotees of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, answered the call with exemplary acts of sacrifice. For example, Sheikh Muhammad Hussain of Muradabad and Hakim Fazaldeen of Behra, who get special mention by name in his book Victory of Islam, for exceptional sacrifice of time and money. These then were the humble beginnings, But the seeds of sacrifice had long been sown, and the world would soon begin to see its fruition. There are unparalleled instances of monetary sacrifices offered by Ahmadis, young and old, men and women. When the promised Messiah requested contribution towards the construction of the White Minaret, a fortunate number of people came forward and each donated either a few pesas or a few rupees. Though the sum may seem rather insignificant now, the fact of the matter is that the Jama'at-e-Ahmadiyya is still reaping the fruits of those early sacrifices, with the result that more and more minarets are being built in all corners of the world. And long may they continue to do so. A special list of 101 contributors to this peal feature prominently in the history of Ahmadiyyat. These are our revered ancestors, whose families will reap the benefits of the sacrifices forever. In response to Hazrat Masih Maud's appeal of 28th of May 1900 for the construction of Minaratul Masih, a shining example was set by one of the most revered ladies of the Ahmadi community, Sayyidah Nusrat Jahan Begum Sahiba, radiallahu ta'ala anha, may Allah be pleased with her, affectionately known as Hazrat Amma Jan. This noble lady contributed a tenth of the projected expenditure of 10,000 rupees by selling one of her properties in New Delhi. This sacrifice alone has reaped unbounded fruits in later years by prompting other ladies of the Jamaat to partake of this very rewarding act. Ever since this early sacrifice, displays of Amma Jan, the spirit amongst women members of the Ahmadi Jamaat in the field of monetary sacrifices for building of mosques became unconfined. They say that diamonds are a girl's best friend, and there is certainly an element of truth in that. Of all the material things in the world, regardless of whether she is black or white, Muslim or non-Muslim, woman regards jewelry as her most prized and personal possession. But where there is a confrontation between spiritual and worldly matters, the Ahmadi lady stands unique, head and shoulders above her other counterparts, of sacrificing those very things that she holds very dear to her. In appeals for building of the mosque in Europe, for example, thousands upon thousands of ladies have bared their wrists and fingers free of all jewelry for all the sake of Allah. These ladies certainly belong to the category of those mentioned in the Holy Quran, who expend of what they love of their belongings. May Allah reward them one and all. The role of the Ahmadi missionary in the history of Ahmadiyyat has played a most prominent and significant role. These are members of a unique and select fraternity who have pledged their lives totally to the will of God. During the very early period of the second Khilafat, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Sani radiallahu ta'ala anhu asked young Ahmadis to come forward and make pledges for Waqfe Zindagi, and these became the pioneering missionaries in foreign and faraway lands, hoping to fulfill one of the prophecies vouchsafed to the promised Messiah, "I will cause thy message to reach the corners of the world." Some of them had to go to countries and continents they never knew existed. As the resources of the Jamaat at that time were meager, to say the least, travel allowances were extremely restricted and only bare minimum could be afforded. The missionaries could only travel alone, leaving their families and loved ones behind. Some of them were young husbands, leaving their wives of only a few months. Some wives were even left carrying a child who might never see their father, nor the father the child, because those embarking on long journeys via land or sea to unknown territories would be completely left in the dark, with only God as a guide and protector and provider. And this is the ring that we wear, Allah salla bi kafin abda. It is Allah who is sufficient for his servants. Some of the pioneering missionaries who went to Africa had literally to live in the jungles, in mud huts, sleeping on uncovered ground, with danger of wildlife, danger of the natives, danger of disease. Some of the most prominent and successful Ahmadiyya missionaries to Africa included Hazrat Maulana Abdul Rahim Nayar and Maulana Sheikh Mubarak Ahmed Sahib. The beauty of all these sacrifices is that there was no coercion, no compulsion, no gun behind their back, nor were there promises of physical wealth or worldly honor and accolades that tempted them to undertake these life-threatening journeys and daunting missions. This was done with the spirit of free and voluntary willingness on their parts, only to win the pleasure of Allah. In the Ahmadi missionary is infused all the criteria for total sacrifice, which encompasses time, life, wealth, and honor. In the short time left, I almost run out of time. I'll give a few examples. Maulana Rahmat Ali was Ahmadiyya Jama'at's first missionary to Indonesia way back in 1922, when the finances of Jama'at were severely strained. He was in Indonesia for more than 10 years at a time when he was brought back, and he was sent back again, and he served for a period of 26 years in Indonesia without his family. Similarly, another example is of Maulvi Zahur Hussain, the pioneer Ahmadiyya Muslim missionary to the USSR. Maulvi Zahur Hussain, an Arabic scholar of considerable eminence, was sent to Bukhara in the USSR in 1924. At that time, the USSR was the bastion and champion of communism and atheistic belief. To even think of going there to preach the existence of God would be like walking into a lion's den. But there is no ordinary reasoning behind the thinking of God's real lions of Islam. When Maulvi Sahab was warned that he would, in all probability, he would not be able to obtain a visa, his reply was that aspect was irrelevant to him. He would go to the USSR, visa or no visa, and this was no empty undertaking. Maulvi Sahib bravely entered the USSR, and sure enough, he was arrested by the Russian authorities as soon as he set foot on the Russian territory, and kept him under rigorous imprisonment in Tashkent, Moscow and other places for 2 long years. During his captivity, Maulvi Sahib suffered such hardships and tortures as a mere mention of these would prevent events would raise one's hairs stand on end. The fruits of his sacrifice, Maulvi Sahib will surely get in the hereafter. But even on this earth, his progeny is receiving endless bounties and rewards. His 3 sons are successful in their professions as lawyers or bankers in the United States. But the highest allocate given to him was by Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Sani radiallahu ta'ala anhu on March 10, 1944, at a large Jamaat gathering in Lahore. When mentioning him by name, Hazur said that the sacrifice made by Maulvi Zahur Hussain proved beyond doubt that God has blessed this Jamaat with workers who would not hesitate for a moment to shed the last drop of their blood in the cause of Ahmadiyyat. Hazur went on to say, God has given me such swords as would cut down kufr with one single stroke. He has given me followers who would respond to my call wherever and in whatever condition they might be. If I tell some of them to leap down from the top of a mountain, they will do so without blinking an eyelid. This is the height of spirituality that we have to aspire for, that of al-mukhbitin, those that are humble and whose hearts are filled when the name of Allah is mentioned, and who patiently endure whatever befalls them, and who observe prayer and the spend of Allah has provided for them. There are so many blessings, I have only time to mention one, MTA International. It seems that the bounties of God are endless. What a transformation the Jamaat worldwide has undergone since the start of MTA. This has revolutionized our television watching habits, our tabligh and tarbiyat methods. And more importantly, it has made the Khalifa of the time much closer to all Ahmadis all around the world. His messages and guidance are relayed instantaneously to every Ahmadi around the world, and this perhaps is one of the greatest of the fruits of sacrifice of our ancestors, who themselves had very close relations with promised Messiah and their Khulafa. The Arabs, with all their money and oil at their mercy, could not initiate such a noble venture because the spirit of sacrifice cannot be bought. It is inherited through the sacrifices of noble and virtuous predecessors. It is up to us to maintain this undying spirit of and impart it to our progeny. The spirit of sacrifice is a trait of the Ahmadiyya Jamaat. This is a Jamaat that is proud of its heritage, of its ancestry, and of its golden sacrifices. But this is not a Jamaat that sits on its laurels, nor one that merely reminisces about its glorious past for self-glorification. The Ahmadiyya Jamaat is a progressive Jamaat, a dynamic Jamaat that will not lead the world into the next, not only lead the world into the next millennium, but lead it will also until the day of judgment. This is a matter that has been decreed and stamped with a divine seal of approval. And as sure as I am standing in front of you, and as sure as night follows day, you can be sure that it is through Ahmadiyyat, the true Islam, and through our sacrifices of our generation, past, present, and future, that the world will achieve true salvation, and no power on earth, political, nuclear, atomic, or otherwise, can prevent that fact. So it is up to us, every Ahmadi, man, woman, and child, whether we want to be included in this exclusive list of those fortunate devotees who are willing to sacrifice their all for the sake of God, to the extent of offering ourselves as sacrificial lambs to the slaughter at God's behest. So, in my last prayer, oh, to be able to achieve the spirit of sacrifice so high that if we were ever offered the sun on the right and the moon on the left, the decision should come as easily and as conclusively as it did our master and perfect exemplar, Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam.